Deep in the Egyptian desert, an ecosystem is under siege. And an ancient river beast, once sacred, is fighting to survive. The giant Nile perch. Now, in crocodile-infested waters, one expedition team is determined to tag this legendary Nile hunter. But to help save it, they first have to find it. It's an urgent mission to an ancient lair. Two scientists, 7 days, and 300 miles of open water.
Get in the boat, watch out, Allah.
Can they catch and track a whopper prehistoric predator before it disappears?
Get behind me, stand up, Ollie.
It's Hooked, Lake Monsters. Egypt. Here, an ancient civilization worshipped animals they believed held mystical powers. Anubis, jackal-headed god of the dead. Bast, feline protector of fertility. Horus, half falcon, half man, god of war. And one of the most sacred and mythical beasts of all was the giant Nile perch. The fabled fish grew to be so huge, it could dwarf the fishermen who caught them. Pharaohs immortalized them. The pious refused to eat them. Some even mummified them as sacred offerings to the gods. This legendary ancient predator has hunted Egypt's most famous waterway for millennia, taking its name from the Nile River.
One of the most important fish for the ancient Egyptians was the Nile perch. And you see it in tomb reliefs and even in temples, because this was this huge fish, and they symbolize this sense of rebirth and resurrection. The Egyptians thought it was a really fearsome fish.
But today, the Nile perch is a species in crisis. In its native range on the Nile River, facing pollution and overfishing, the fabled whopper is disappearing. Total population unknown. Many of the Nile River's last leviathans lurk here. Lake Nasser, a remote Nile reservoir. To save this treasured icon where it once thrived, Lake Nasser may be the final frontier. But time is running out. March 21st, 2010. Cairo, Egypt. Justin Grubich is an assistant professor at the American University in Cairo. He's launching the first ever Lake Nasser Nile perch expedition. He hopes to tag the biggest Nile perch he can find and track the prehistoric predator for 24 hours. In the fight to protect this mammoth river beast, knowledge is power.
What I'd really like to figure out about the Nile perch is where they spend their time, where they eat, where they reproduce. That's what we need to know, first of all, so we can start protecting them. A lot of them are overfished these days, even in the Nile area where they're a native.
Crayfish, everyone.
Mm-hmm.
Across an ocean in Alexandria, Virginia, another scientist prepares to join the Nile perch mission.
Yeah, the water's clearing up a little bit.
John Odenkirk is a fisheries biologist with over 20 years experience tagging and tracking freshwater fish.
We've been successful getting some juveniles out of here in the past survey.
John specializes in using advanced technology, monitoring dangerous exotic fish in American waters. He was the first scientist to implant a radio tracking tag in the notorious northern snakehead, an invasive species that threatens U.S. fisheries. Now, for the first time, John will travel to Egypt to tackle the opposite problem, tagging a native species in danger in its ancient home.
John has intimate knowledge and kind of a, maybe a sixth sense, you might say, on where fish may go. So that kind of innate sense or experience that he has in tracking fish will be incredibly helpful and indispensable, really.
When I got the phone call to see if I was interested in going to Egypt, it just seemed a little too good to be true. I'd love to see a big Nile perch up close. You know, it seems like a bizarre concept to me as a biologist and an angler to be able to go after a freshwater fish that conceivably could be bigger than I am.
March 23rd, 2010, Aswan, Egypt.
You Justin?
Yeah, John.
Great to meet you, Father.
Pleasure, man.
Expedition day one of seven. John Odenkirk, Justin Grubich, and the team's research assistant, Ali Femi, gather together for the first time.
All right, let's do it, man.
All right, let's go.
They begin the desert trek to Lake Nasser in search of some of the Nile's last remaining giant perch.
Lake Nasser, huh?
That's it, man. That's where we're gonna be hunting the giant Nile perch.
Looks like the lake's down a pretty good ways. You think that'll be good for fishing?
I hope so.
Hello.
I'm John.
Ahmed.
All right. Nice to meet you.
To help them navigate the vast Lake Nasser, Justin and John are teaming up with a group of veteran local fishing guides.
You ready to catch some big fish?
I'm definitely ready.
Yet no amount of experience can guarantee a whopper catch. Lake Nasser is the second largest man-made lake in the world. Covering some 2,000 square miles, tracking a giant Nile perch here may be an impossible challenge. To date, no expedition has even attempted it. And the team must face another notorious aquatic predator, the Nile crocodile. Growing up to 20 feet long, Africa's largest crocs kill an estimated 200 people a year. Two biologists can only guess what species they'll find in these waters.
What's fascinating about Lake Nasser is that we don't really have a good baseline knowledge of what the biodiversity of fishes is in this lake.
But one thing is known. In the last decades, as human populations swell, increasing demand for the Nile perch and two of the perch's favorite prey, tilapia and tigerfish, has taken its toll. Giant perch once grew up to 6 feet long, weighing nearly a quarter ton. Now, in this threatened ecosystem, such whoppers are rare.
There's a lot of fishing pressure here, and that has the potential to not only take the prey species that the perch need to survive, but also as a non-target, they're catching the young perch before they have a chance to mature and sustain the population.
As the river whoppers disappear, the mission's challenge goes beyond catching a truly giant Nile perch. They also want to tag one using state-of-the-art technology. To implant an acoustic tracking device called a telemetry tag, the team must make a surgical incision in the perch's gut, embedding the tag securely as possible. The harmless tag will remain in the fish indefinitely. But the visiting expedition has only a narrow window. Once the fish is back in the water, the team hopes to track the tag's acoustic pulse instantaneously on a handheld receiver.
What we will get is basically hour-by-hour data that tells us how deep the fish is, what temperature, water temperature it's in, and where it's actually moving and going hour by hour. And that will help us build a daily picture, or a 24-hour cycle picture of the life of a Nile perch.
A 24-hour picture may someday mean the difference between native Nile perch survival and dangerous decline. But there's a problem. The signal has a limited range. To capture a day in the life of this ancient alpha predator, the team must stay within 200 yards. Stray further, and they risk losing the signal. Move closer, and they risk spooking the fish and altering its behavior. The expedition must physically chase their perch across Lake Nasser, going wherever the elusive hunter roams.
It's a very difficult task, very difficult at best. You know, we don't know the water. We don't know what the fish's behavior is going to be. So essentially, we have a bit of a handicap going into this thing. So it's just, you know, we have to be on our toes.
Eight a.m. Expedition day 2 of 7.
Well, John, looks like we got a great day here. We're gonna catch some fish.
Excellent.
All right, man. What kind of rods we got working up there? We got the right stuff going on?
Yeah, they're all rigged. A lot of them are rigged, ready to go.
Combined, Justin and John have decades of fishing experience tackling monsters in remote waters.
That's a nice one, huh?
Look at that beast. Something that eats something that big is going to be big.
That's what we want. That's what we're looking for. Whatever thinks this is a snack.
That's right.
Yet even for veteran anglers, the giant Nile perch remains one of the most legendary and intimidating river beasts on Earth. Built like powerful, scaly submarines, giant Nile perch are lethal ambush hunters. Stalking and charging prey, their massive jaws extend, allowing them to swallow their victims whole. And Nile perch top the freshwater food chain as one of the largest fish in the world. For the team, luring a giant Nile perch is as much an art as a science. The apex predators are highly sensitized to their prey. Mimic a tasty tilapia or tiger fish just right, and a Nile perch may go in for the kill.
This is a Bucra depth raider, and this lure is good because it's gonna be traveling at the right depth and mimics the prey fish that are found in this reservoir. So we're gonna tie this bait on here and hope that it attracts some Nile perch.
With their lures set just below the surface, Justin and John troll across Lake Nasser. They scan the water, anxious for their first glimpse of a Nile perch.
Fish on! Fish on!
Then, with a sudden jolt,
he's a tiger.
Justin has a fighting fish on his line.
Yeah, good tiger. Here, oh, he's gonna jump. Oh yeah, all right.
It's no Nile perch, but it is a fearsome predator. The
nice
team's
tiger.
First chance to battle a river beast face to face, the piranha of Africa.
Nice tiger.
On the hunt for a legendary prehistoric predator, the giant Nile perch, biologist
nice
Justin
tiger.
Grubich fights a tug of war against another notorious river beast, the tiger fish.
Ahmed?
Yes.
You got a gaff for him? We're gonna get him in. Hold on. Ollie, lift your rod up, Ollie. Come on. Watch out.
There you go.
Ow! Yeah! That is what I was looking for. Look at that.
On the Clark spin.
That is what I was looking for. Nice tiger. Woo! That's exciting, the way it was jumping. Man, it hit it like lightning. Nice fish. Look at those teeth on that thing. Wow. Super, super catch.
Justin knows any fish he catches helps unlock the mysteries of Lake Nasser's underwater food chain. To help save the disappearing giant Nile perch, he must uncover as much information as possible about its hunting grounds. Tigerfish sport a mouthful of flesh-ripping, razor-sharp teeth that can decimate prey in seconds. And like their South American piranha cousins, these tenacious hunters feed in deadly mobs.
So what we have here is a magnificent specimen of a tigerfish, a big adult. It's just a fascinating fish. It's built for speed. He has these jaws that articulate like a bear trap. And as those clamp down, see those teeth interdigitate, they interlock with each other, taking chunks of flesh out of the prey. There would be a school of fish similar to this size that are hunting in packs, and they're going along the edges of this submerged vegetation, and they dart forward with a lightning strike and chomp right through the fish. It's really an amazing predator.
Besides the Nile crocodile, a large tigerfish is the only predator big enough to attack a Nile perch, but only for so long. Once growing Nile perch reach their full size potential, there's no contest. Perch rule the fish food chain. So massive, virtually no other predator can touch them. Yet now, as the team continues their quest to catch and tag a whopper Nile perch, the day's fishing brings no luck. Expedition day 3 of 7. After more long hours trolling Lake Nasser, the team's unlucky streak continues.
Feeling all right?
Nothing yet.
No bites?
No bites.
No bumps?
No bumps. Smooth vibration.
Concentrate. See the fish.
See through the water.
Take. Take. Fish.
As dusk approaches, Justin hopes their luck will change. In general, nighttime fishing in Lake Nasser is extremely dangerous. Poor light and rocky conditions are treacherous. The team knows they must focus their energies on daylight fishing hours. Yet as they run out of time, they may be forced to push the limit.
Well, it's relatively well known that they're nocturnal feeders, so they're gonna be, we expect them to be pretty active during twilight and sunrise. When the light is just getting low enough, that's when most predators are most active. The expectation is, because they're very large fish, that they probably have certain territories that they defend, and that's kind of where they hang out. How large that territory is, we have no idea. So what the range of that territory is something that we're hoping to figure out.
The team scans the lake for any signs of whopper perch. John and Justin want their tagging data to come from a strong, healthy specimen, able to withstand the stress of tagging. The men agree they'll only tag a Nile perch weighing at least 50 pounds. But they also know, in an overfished ecosystem, the bigger the target specimen, the smaller the odds of finding one. Justin changes strategies. He switches to a fishing lure designed to skim closer to the surface.
So as we're going to the shallow water where they're predominantly most of their prey is, this is going to be a better bait because it dives a little bit shallower, doesn't go as deep.
Now, under the murky waters, Justin believes the team's target predator may just be warming up. Expedition day 4. There's still no sign of Nile perch. With only 3 days remaining on the mission, the team grows increasingly worried their target may be too scarce to catch. biologist Justin Grubich considers an unusual but ancient strategy, enlisting the help of another sacred animal, the Nile crocodile.
The Nile crocodile, of course, has been, just like the giant Nile perch, revered in Egypt all the way back into pharaonic times, into antiquity. The pharaonic god Serbic is actually a crocodile-headed god that is the god of the Nile, that protects the Nile and the drainage and all the wildlife within it. If it happens that we aren't catching a giant Nile perch, John and I may actually have to make a prayer to the pharaonic god Serbic in order to hopefully get in his favor so that he'll send a giant Nile perch our way.
Half man, half crocodile, the mighty god of the River Nile was both feared and revered. Yet Serbic was not alone. He ruled with another powerful deity, the hunting goddess Neith. In one famous creation myth, Neith turned herself into a Nile perch to swim the sacred waters that gave life.
Neith is a warrior goddess, and the Nile perch is a great hunter. The animals had special talents that were associated with that god or became associated with that god.
But in ancient Egypt, no fisherman's fortune could be secure without the blessings of the holy ruler of the Nile, Serbic. 3 p.m. on the shore of Lake Nasser, Abu Simbel, Egypt.
This is going to change our luck, right?
In search of Serbic, Justin, fellow biologist John Odenkirk, and research assistant Ali Femi make a pilgrimage to one of Egypt's most famous ancient temples. Built by Ramses II in the 13th century BC, the entrance features four mammoth carvings of the pharaoh king himself. Inside, a shrine of Serbic waits.
And you brought an offering?
Yeah. I think I'll offer an acknowledgement in the paper that we write together, John.
You think that's going to be good enough?
I hope so.
Reaching the inner sanctum of King Ramses II's temple, the team appeals to an ancient deity to send the Nile's fabled giant perch their way.
And that's Serbic. He's the god of the Nile. He's got the head of a crocodile.
Excellent.
He's got a spear in his hand. Hopefully he'll shine down upon us and give us some luck so we can get a giant Nile perch.
Mabuka,
huh? I think it's going to change our luck, John. I think so.
That's about it.
Let's get back to the boat.
Yeah, let's get back to some fishing and some science.
Back on Lake Nasser, it's expedition day 5 of 7. The team now counts their remaining time in hours. To gain valuable data on giant Nile perch, they want to track a tagged specimen for a 24-hour cycle. Their window of opportunity is fast disappearing.
We only hope that we'll find some fish later today.
6 p.m., dusk. It's the time of day Justin hopes hunting Nile perch go in for the kill. The team watches every motion and shadow on the water.
Whoa! Fish! Fish on!
First, a quick jolt. Then, John feels a powerful tug on his line.
And he feels good!
John struggles to maintain enough tension.
Damn!
While keeping the fighting fish hooked.
He's gonna jump!
Jump!
He's gonna jump!
As the whopper clears the water, Justin and John get their first glimpse of their expedition's target.
Woo-hoo.
It's a Nile perch.
Uh-oh.
Reeling as hard and steadily as he can, as the writhing fish tries to break free, John must maneuver the perch to the boat.
Yeah, baby, that's what I'm talking about.
Woo!
With a strong final pull, John has his catch exactly where he wants it.
Oh, that's a real fish.
That's a big fish.
That's a nice fish.
But something's wrong.
Look, he's got a gill net in his mouth.
No,
was that on my bait?
Yeah, it's a gill.
It's got a gill net all wrapped up in his mouth.
Examining the fish, John and Justin can see a piece of net blocking the Nile perch's throat. Unable to swallow food, the predator is slowly starving to death. John's catch has now turned into a rescue mission.
You know what, John? We should cut that out.
Yeah.
I've got a knife in my pocket.
We need a light.
He was probably trying to eat fish out of a net.
John must be extremely careful not to harm the perch any further.
Well, a gill net's going to last a long time. It's not going to break down very easily.
Damn gill net.
The fish probably eventually would have died a slow death because it wouldn't have been able to gain nutrition through efficient foraging. And so we actually probably did that fish a huge favor.
Nice fish, John.
Oh, man.
The fish is large and mature enough to tag, but John and Justin can only guess how long the lodge net kept the perch from feeding. Fearing the fish isn't healthy enough to weather more stress, they want to release it as fast as possible.
Well done.
All right, bud. Finally got you one.
Put him in the lake for later, too.
Too sudden of a release can be dangerous. After a catch, tired, slow-swimming fish are vulnerable to predators. The team must help the perch regain its fighting strength.
His gills are flaring.
Yeah,
he's pumping oxygen.
He's feeling good.
He's in good shape. Give him a minute.
You feel good?
Yeah.
Happy, healthy? Yeah, oh yeah.
There he goes.
Down to the depths. Bye-bye. Good swim, good swim. You put me on the fish. Sure, man.
It was very special to be able not only to release it to fight another day, but to help it out by removing that gill net from it and see it swim off strong.
Well done.
All right, bud. Finally got you one.
The last couple hours have been really good to me.
Yeah. I guess that that prayer to Serbeck is finally paying off.
But now, as the men face the last 2 days of their Lake Nasser expedition, the mission's chances to catch, tag, and track a whopper Nile perch may be lost. Mm-hmm. 10 a.m., expedition day 6 of 7. Back on shore, the team holds an emergency strategy meeting with the fishing guides and crew. There's less than 48 hours remaining.
You know, our first priority is try to find that big Nile perch.
Yes.
Here it looks like there's been quite a bit of fishing pressure. So I favor a move to some new kind of virgin ground.
Subu, anyway, the Subu Sertem is many fishing places. We have a lot of sinking island, a lot of shore fishing area, a lot of shore shallow places, deep areas.
I think we need to move.
Yeah.
I think we should skedaddle up to that area if that's where the fishing reports are coming from. Every day without a Nile perch is a day lost on the research.
Yeah,
so.
To cover as much territory as possible, Justin and John decide to divide and conquer.
See the black rock that's sitting on the corner?
Yeah.
But it's a risky strategy. If one of the men catches a large Nile perch, he may need the other's help in planting the telemetry tag.
We're really getting to the critical hour now that we really need to catch a big Nile perch so we can tag it and then monitor it, because the expedition's coming to a close, so we're a little bit anxious that we catch a big Nile perch today. Fish on! Fish on!
Justin's hooked a monster.
Reel in, Ollie, reel in as fast as you can. Under the boat, he's under the boat.
Under, but you can't run.
I know. Can you get the motor up?
Yes.
Okay.
Around.
Yeah. Yes. A good fish. He's gonna jump. Oh yeah! This is a taggable fish here.
It's a Goliath Nile perch. It may be the expedition's last chance to tag and track this elusive river beast.
He's gonna jump again. Here it goes.
But now, as Justin fights for control, his expedition partner John is fishing on the other side of the lake. John's too far out to help Justin and Ollie with the tagging.
You're above me, get behind me, stand up, Ollie.
Justin must quickly teach Ollie how to wrangle monster fish before it's too late.
Not yet, he's still green. He's coming soon.
For Justin, it's the ultimate angling challenge. For Ollie, it's baptism by fire.
Okay, Ollie.
Yeah?
We're gonna need a tail rope and the Boca grip.
What? A rope?
I wish John was here.
I think that's...
To ensure the catch stays healthy and strong, Justin and Ollie will have mere minutes to perform the surgery, securing the acoustic telemetry tag. But first, Justin has to land the Nile perch, bringing the ancient fabled beast into the boat.
Come to the boat.
Up.
This is a good fish here, people. He's gonna come up. Okay, guys. Not yet. He's still green. But he's coming soon. Come on, baby. This is the most important part right here.
Justin manages to wrangle the perch to the boat. But the real test has just begun.
We can bring him up here. Bring him up here.
To keep the fish healthy, he has only a few minutes to take measurements.
Ollie, get my kit. Okay. Kit.
And judge if it's mature enough for the telemetry tag.
Get your notepad out. I'm gonna start barking some data.
To get the most useful data on species behavior, and to avoid overstressing weaker fish, biologists avoid juveniles.
Total length, 116.
Instead, they target what they call breeders, strong fish old enough to spawn.
Ooh, I took a knock on my foot, look at that. That's okay. That's good stuff, that's a spine from a Nile perch right there. Good fun. Okay, gape, 17.
The fish weighs in at 70 pounds. It's a perfect candidate for tagging.
Actually, I think I can do the surgery and we can tag him and lease him. Okay, Ollie, get the transmitter out. The receiver out. Go in the black box. Get the hydrophone.
Justin makes a small incision in the fish's abdomen and inserts the transmitter.
Tag is in. Okay. All right, so let's let him recover a second.
For a safe release, time is critical.
That's good.
Is he okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Woo, I'm shaking. I'm shaking, I got a bloody foot, but that is well worth the price.
Before they release the perch, the team must verify their acoustic receiver is picking up signals from the embedded telemetry tag.
Ooh. Ah, we got it, you guys wanna hear it? You want to hear it, Ollie?
Yeah, I want to hear.
Hear pinging?
I hear it, yeah.
That's our boy. It's a sequence of pings that are characteristic of this specific tag that has a certain serial number. It simultaneously is recording depth and temperature and a GPS location. So once we let this fish rest a little bit, we're going to start monitoring its movements through the lake for as long as we can keep track of it.
The tag is working. Justin's confident the Nile perch is ready for a release. He finishes suturing as fast as possible.
That is a strong fish. A good candidate for tagging. A hardy fish like that can withstand a lot of stress.
They let the fish rest a few final moments before returning it to the depths of Lake Nasser.
All right, now we'll release our first giant Nile perch. Let's see where he goes. That is awesome, alhamdulillah. Amen. You are the man. Shukran gazila. When he hit it so hard, he actually cracked the lure. That's how strong these fish are. It's unbelievable. We were lucky to land him. Very lucky to land him.
For the expedition, it's the moment of truth. The tag's range is only 200 yards. To gather the data they need, they must follow the Nile perch across the second largest man-made lake on Earth. No team has ever done it. Justin quickly gets to work. A handheld device called a hydrophone collects and stores signals from the acoustic tag in the fish's gut. The closer the fish, the stronger the signal, and the louder the ping.
We're good. That's music to my ears right there. Bing, 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 bing. That's good. That's data. That's science. That's sexy. Swallow, swallow. Check, check.
Well, we just got in the lunch here, calling our way in, and nothing really going on.
Well, John, we could use your help over here. We just tagged a 70-pounder.
Believe it when I see the data.
Well, get your butt over here, man. We need some help.
12 p.m., expedition day 6. John Odenkirk missed the tagging surgery, but as one of U.S. Fisheries' most experienced aquatic trackers, his judgment calls over the next 24 hours could mean the difference between mission success and failure.
Well, John has really good experience in tracking animals. He's done it a lot in North America, so his expertise in predicting where the fish is going to go and what we expect it to do will be really great, really helpful. 70 pounds! Tagging, he's sitting under that rock over there.
How long ago?
Half hour or so.
You already got it done and back out?
Yeah.
Sweet. Carlos Urana.
All right, bud. Oh, yeah. Listen to this sweet music.
Nice.
He's sitting right over there.
Now, which hydrophone do you have?
Right now, it's just the omnidirectional. We're letting him catch his breath.
Where's it sitting?
It's underneath the boat.
Oh, okay.
It's right over the side. So he's sitting against those rocks. We caught him in that little bay, and wind pushed us this direction, and fought it. He jumped like 3 times.
Really?
Big head, gills flaring.
No way.
Yeah, his head was going. And he actually broke the back end of the actual lure off. So yeah, it was good. Struggled. All right, Ollie, come on over. We're gonna have a little strategy session here.
All right.
So we just got this fish tagged. Let's track it for the next 24 hours. We've got it in this nice little area here. 24 hours, we'll be able to figure out what it's doing overnight. So I'm gonna need you on the receiver at first and you on the hydrophone. I mean, if it starts to move, we need to be ready to move with it.
Otherwise, okay? We lose it.
That's right.
The team has no way to predict if their strategy will work.
What's the readout now?
76.
Yeah. He was in this little cut
in
the back of this cove, and then when he heard the boat coming, he moved out.
Even with a steady signal from the telemetry tag, physically tracking the fish in Lake Nasser might be impossible.
There's plenty of places to lose a fish in this basically inland sea. We really are kind of flying blind here. What the fish is going to end up doing, we really don't have any ideas. So we just hope we can stay close enough to be able to follow the fish through a significant amount of time. Where do you have him positioned now?
6 p.m. Nice. Roughly 6 hours after releasing the tagged Nile perch, the signal remains strong. The expedition team must stay within 200 yards and follow their target through the night.
All right, I'm gonna turn a little bit clockwise. Now, sounding less.
Less,
now?
Yeah, less.
I just got a good ping there, though.
So we're basically in the same cove where we've just released this giant Nile perch earlier in the day, and it doesn't seem to have moved much. We're gonna be taking tracks of it every half hour until it starts to really move when it starts hunting it during the night. Try just flipping over to this side, John.
Just to get out of the grass. What's the readout now?
67, 68 decibels, 3.1 meters. Right now, the sun is starting to set, so we're getting to that twilight period where nocturnal predators like the giant Nile perch start to feed. They go in, they come along the edges and try to ambush these tilapia prey that hide in the milfoil weeds along the edge of this rocky outcropping. So he's sitting right there at 2.7 meters. He's real shallow.
What we'll be doing tonight is we're gonna be tracking these fish across Lake Nasser. Now, the fish may not move tonight, or it may not move, you know, but just so much, a little bit. The lake is very, the bathymetry is very rugged. And luckily we have skilled guide with us, because if it was Justin and I driving this boat around, and we probably end up sinking the damn thing.
I'm wondering if we pushed him out of this little dip here and he went around the point.
What we found with this, the first few logs that we've got here on this fish, is that it's moving.
I think he has moved since the last check.
And it's moving off of the location where the release site was, which is good.
I think he's either going a little bit beyond that point, or he's moved offshore a little bit.
8 p.m.
Yeah, straight in.
Okay. Monitoring on.
You got a fix on where our cove is?
Justin's instincts are right on target. The tagged nocturnal predator is on the move, heading fast across Lake Nasser.
22 degrees north, 743 minutes. 32 degrees east, 491 east. 61.
You know where I'm pointing? Pointing straight out. He's going out. He's out here.
He's heading offshore.
Working in complete darkness, the team's calculations are mission critical, facing hundreds of miles of open water. The Nile Perch Expedition's final day approaches. Nearing midnight, Justin Grubich, John Odenkirk, and Ali Femi track the tagged perch's every move.
Coming offshore, and it's getting stronger still.
But they're about to face their worst scenario. A sudden windstorm creates huge swells. In the pitch black, surrounded by jutting rocks, the team must decide whether it's too dangerous to continue.
With this wind kicking up, though, I don't know. I hope it doesn't get too rough out here.
It was whitecapping a little while ago.
Well, that can really affect the way the hydrophone reads, actually. When the lake conditions change, you get, you know, erroneous signals, and we could easily lose them.
As the tagged Nile perch speeds across choppy waters, the men refuse to quit.
How far do you think we came that last run? Yeah, he's this way.
The expedition faces their toughest test yet.
Like maybe he's swimming towards us.
The weather worsens, and the biologists have to call off the hunt. As they return to shore, the team has no idea if they'll get another chance to find and track their fish. ...6 a.m., Expedition Day 7. The storm has passed.
Can you grab this and put it on this chair so we can get a reception?
The team returns to Lake Nasser. They set up their acoustic telemetry gear and wait.
We let the fish for a few hours. It was still sitting in its hunting area here all night long, and then so we've come back here at sunrise to try to find it in its last location that we saw it.
Yeah. Is this the spot?
Yeah.
See
him, yeah.
Let's come from the mother side to get a bread here. Nothing.
Nah, he's not here anymore.
The tag signal is lost. The whopper perch is outside the telemetry range.
We were thinking it might track all the way back to where we originally caught it if they do actually kind of feed in a circuit and have a certain territory. But here we are at sunrise, and he's not here right now, so. The mystery of the Nile perch continues.
Yet in the larger quest to understand the Nile's vulnerable ancient hunter, the expedition has broken new ground.
We got a good 12 hours on that fish, so that's the first tracking of a giant Nile perch for 12 hours, so that's a great success.
It's a very good feeling. We caught Nile perch, we tagged Nile perch, we tracked Nile perch. Essentially, we accomplished everything we wanted to accomplish.
Justin's theory of Nile perch feeding. Rather than meandering on the hunt, Justin believes the fish speed along predetermined routes. Once they feasted, they circle back and start the cycle again.
Having this fundamental ecological information on the giant Nile perch will be very important in developing conservation and management strategies to ensure that we protect the biodiversity of Lake Nasser.
For biologists Justin Grubich and John Odenkirk, the Lake Nasser mission was a critical pilot study. The prehistoric hunters are disappearing from their most ancient lair, but tagging breakthroughs have helped science understand some of the planet's most extraordinary fish. Now, an ancient river icon may be the next protected predator on Hooked: lake monsters.